Hey everyone, looking out at this view, right? You can't see it from the angle that the camera's at, but there's that cornfield. Maybe some of you have seen sometimes I do these little videos here and the camera's facing out there. You can see the cornfield, and right now everything's just covered in snow, which I'm sure you can see along the side here. And we got our first nor'easter, which they say has been one of the worst nor'easters we've had in a while. It didn't look that much to me. People were driving the same day, but I mean, it's definitely white. It's definitely dropped some snow. And immediately when it was happening, I think, days before Christmas, and here it is. I'm dreaming of a white Christmas. We're getting our wish. But that song's kind of funny because Jesus was not born in December. This date was picked for other reasons we won't go into now. But Jesus was born in spring, based on what we know about shepherds and flocks and when they'd be in certain fields and the stars that they'd be looking for, all that. We know, most likely scholars think probably around April, Jesus was born, and there's not snow usually in April. I do remember it one time, but, usually you don't see snow in April. So in some ways, snow at Christmas, if you know the context, the original context, it doesn't fit. And yet, in a weird other way, it does, right? Because the most popular verse I can think of about snow in Scripture is, though your sins be as scarlet, I have made them white as snow. And when you understand Christmas through the lens of the cross and the resurrection, when you look first through the empty tomb back to the manger, you discover, right, the whole reason this child was born. And so he was born to make us white as snow and give us life everlasting. And so in that sense, it's really appropriate to have snow in Christmas as a metaphor, so to speak. We're going to be looking at that and trying to really capture the joy of what that means today. And so I hope that you'll tune in and watch this video and watch our series and watch our sermons. This whole Advent series has been kind of leading up to this final week of Advent, and it's all about joy, and it's about the joy that we have that I think can only be experienced when you look at the life of Jesus in reverse. You look from the tomb to the manger. And so again, our service is gonna come up shortly, and then afterwards we have a little devotion right here, and so I'll see you back then.
Merry Christmas, everyone. We are heading into Christmas week, right? The countdown is on. That's better than trying to find out exactly how many days there are, depending on when people are watching this. We will have a couple Christmas carols to start off with, and we'll kind of loop around at the end and tie it in. But the worship set today is going to take maybe a little different strain than you've probably heard before. But we're excited about it. We're excited to worship God. We're excited to sing about the goodness of Jesus Christ, the love of Almighty God, the perfect love that is in the manger. So we're going to sing, "O Come All Ye Faithful," and into the first Noel. Hopefully you know them and sing along. Come and behold. precious to thee be all glory given. Word of the Father, now in flesh appearing. Oh, come let us adore him. Oh, come let us adore him. Oh, come let us adore him. Christ the Lord. Amen. Amen. Come all ye faithful, come all ye sinners, come anyone who wants to celebrate the birth of our King. Lord, every time we say that word, Lord, we have to think of your kingship. We're so grateful for salvation, Lord. So grateful. But it's your kingship that keeps us from straying. And so we celebrate you today. We celebrate you every day. Lord, I pray that your awesomeness and your influence, your purpose and your destiny at the cross shines through this Christmas. In a season where so many people are looking for hope, oh, do you have something to offer them? The first Noel the angels did say was to certain poor shepherds in fields as they lay. In fields where they lay keeping their sheep on a cold winter's night that was so deep. Noel, 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 Noel. Born is the King of Israel. They looked up and saw a star shining in the east beyond them far, and to the earth it gave great light. So it continued both day and night. Noel, 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 Noel. Born is the King of Israel. Then let the song with one accord sing praises to our heavenly Lord that hath made heaven and earth of naught, and with his blood mankind has bought. No. Thank you, Lord God, for the birth of your Son. We're going to celebrate this today. Father, we ask through the power of your Holy Spirit to fill us with your word today. Lord, if I could even come and ask humbly for you to empower me to preach the message that's on my heart today, a message of joy, but a message of Christmas that doesn't necessarily begin with the manger, but maybe begins with the victory that you sealed. The very reason that we rejoice. Lord God, fill us and shape us, mold us and challenge us, grow us in the mighty image of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Everyone, we're going to get ready for the message now. We will be back in just a second, and then we'll see you here for more worship at the end. Again, welcome everyone. Our service before Christmas. And today's theme for Advent is joy. And I think joy, very similar to the sermon from 2 weeks ago on inner peace, is something that seems to escape us a lot, right? And there is certainly kind of a relationship, I think, between joy and inner peace, in that when there's a lot of inner conflict, joy seems very hard to grasp. And so I'm going to take a look at joy, but first I want to do a quote from Henry David Thoreau. I don't know if any of you have ever read his Walden Pond book, but I think there's a quote in there from him that sums up why, like inner peace, joy is so hard for people and seems like peace to be elusive. Thoreau wrote in his book, "Most men lead lives of quiet desperation." And I think there's a lot of truth to that statement, right? A lot of people have this internal desperation in them that robs them of peace, like we covered a couple weeks ago, but of joy, of true abounding joy. And so let's work it back. Let's work that quote back and see if we can kind of understand maybe the human dilemma a little bit, or at least understand what's being said about the human dilemma. So here we go. Let's start, work it all the way back, right? Start with the end, desperation. Desperation has two different definitions. Okay, well, it has more than two, but there's two that really, I think, sum up the different ways that it's used. One is having a great need or desire, and the second one is a hopeless situation. Okay, and actually that second definition is the one that pops up the most, and even in the dictionary, it's oftentimes the first definition when you actually look at it in the dictionary. A hopeless situation or having a great need or desire. Now let's go to the word quiet, right? Why? Why is our desperation quiet? We're afraid to admit it. We're afraid to come to terms with it. Right? Afraid to feel it. Get that feeling of desperation out. Squash it down. I can't let people know I feel this way in life because they're going to think something's wrong with me. So we keep that desperation quiet. Lead lives, right? This quiet desperation in some way defines them, runs them, directs them, informs the steps that they take, the ways they protect themselves from pain and hurt and emotional hurt, right? Something about this quiet, desperate situation runs a lot of our insecurities, our inferiorities, our inadequacies, and the like. And then finally, the opening of that quote, "most men." And that tells us that it's common, from Thoreau's perspective anyways, that it was common. And it is common for people to feel, even people that seem like they're on top of the world, the more you get to know them, there was a book, I probably won't get the title right now off the top of my head, but something like, everybody's normal until you get to know them, right? And then you realize we all have this desperation that we're wrestling with, and it's all too common. And I think we as Christians in faith, right, and in the journey of faith, are also desperate, all right? And that sounds like it's going to be a funny way of tying in joy, all right? But if you permit me, let me continue, right? We are desperate, but I'm not so sure that our desperation has to be quiet desperation. It's buried, I think, is it buried in reservation where we want to push it down like so many people do? Or is it possible that our desperation could be joyful? I know that's a paradox. It's a weird paradox of faith, but it's one that I think that we should consider. Because I think from the Christian perspective of faith, I think from looking at the avenue of joy and the time that we live in between the first advent and the second advent when Christ returns, I think that there's this feeling of joyful desperation and not quiet desperation. Let me explain, right? If you remember the two definitions of desperation, one of them, all right, we have a great desire or need or longing. We desire heaven. We desire to see our Master face to face. We desire to see the Lord face to face. 1 John says that when we see him face to face, we don't know who we are yet, but when we see him face to face, we'll be changed, and we will be like him, for we will see him as he truly is. There's something about who we are that's yet to come, and so we're desperate. We're desperate to be closer to God. We're desperate to have the perfect come, as Paul says. We're desperate for the kingdom of God. We're desperate for heaven. We're desperate for the face-to-face presence of Jesus. But we can still be joyful because we don't have the second definition of desperation, which is a hopeless situation, right? We're desperate because of the first definition, a desire, but we are joyful in absence of the second definition of desperation, which is a hopeless situation. Rather, our joy comes from not from the absence of hope, but from an assured hope, like we talked about a couple weeks ago, that faith is the assurance of the things that we hope for. The assurance of that in which we are longing. And so we are hopefully, not hopelessly, desperate for the Lord. And that creates this weird paradox in us of being desperate but being joyful. And so today's sermon is all about a joyful desperation, not a quiet desperation, for those who walk in faith in the Lord. And I want to use this Advent series and, you know, let's think it through and how it plays into that narrative. So like we did with the quote, we're going to start from last week, and then work our way back through the Advent series. Last week, I said the Christ child is God's perfect love. That's what the Christ child in the manger represents. That's what he is, the perfect, untainted love of God. And then we looked and we talked about how that perfect love drives out or casts out, like in an exorcism of demon, right? Casts out all fear, it says in 1 John. And it's a faith that we have now filled with peace, right? Remember we talked about in that peace, that shalom, that inner peace, that sense of wholeness, of fullness, of being complete because fear has been driven out because of the love of God. And perfect love, we also saw right in 1 Peter, produces a confidence in our walk. As the book of Hebrews says, a faith that is the assurance of the things that we hope for. And so the love of God in Christ produces a faith that is rooted in confidence, a certain and assured hope, which allows us to walk in peace in this crazy world. And that is also the reality from which we get joy. It's the same formula, if you will, for our joy. Faith is our joy. Assurance is our joy. Hope is our joy. Peace is our joy. The love of God that we experience in this life is our joy. And these are timeless, tangible, untainted joys that we have in Christ. A joy that's the outpouring and expression of that peace. The outpouring. That's why I wanted to save this one for last. It's like as we worked back, right? Our faith and hope that finds assurance, right? Produces a peace in us, right? That peace, all of this is defined by the love of God, and it lands and it produces a joy in our life that is unable to be robbed from us. Because these things, the love of God, the assurance of hope, no matter what's going on, those are things that the world can't take away. And so peace and joy are things that transcend the moment, transcend our surroundings. Listen to the way the scriptures talk about it, right? If you don't think that peace and hope and the love of God are informing our joy, are landing us now on the final week of Advent. All these things we've been building on are finally landing at joy. Listen to the scriptures. 1 Peter 1, 8 through 9. Though you have not seen him, you love him. Though you do not see him now, you believe in him. There's your faith, right? And rejoice with joy that is inexpressible and filled with glory, obtaining the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. Look, you love him even though you haven't seen him, because we see with a different set of eyes. You have faith and hope in him, and this produces a rejoicing, a joy with inexpressible glory. Proverbs 10:28. The hope of the righteous brings what? Joy. But the expectation of the wicked will perish. Hope produces joy because it looks not right at the circumstances in front of it, but it looks ahead. It works its way back, which is going to be a theme I'm going to keep saying over and over today. You got to look at the expectation and the hope and work back from that expectation, not from the left and from the right and from what's around you, but from the coming hope and the assurance of that hope that we have, the peace in that hope that we have, because the love of God has ensured it for us, makes us confident in our walk with it, and then work its way back to a joy that finds a home right here and now. Romans 15:13, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit you may abound in hope. Abound in it. There's nothing, no power or entity in this world that can rob you of hope or peace or love of God. And so nobody can take your joy. Because joy, according to the scriptures, that's been the whole point of landing here in this Advent series, is rooted in things that are of God, not of this world. If your peace is tied to this world, the world can take it away and take away your joy. If your hope is tied to this world, the world can take it away and rob you of your joy. If your understanding of what it means to be loved as a person, and I mean really feel loved and worth something, if it's tied to the things of this world, you could end up heartbroken and lose your joy. But if your joy is tied to a peace that passes all understanding, a hope that is beyond this world, and a love that we are sure and confident of. Remember the verse from last week, that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present or things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Your joy has to be rooted in the things that are from above, and then it can never be taken. It's got to be rooted in a coming vision, in the thing that we're hoping for. Remember, we read it. We just saw it, right, in the scripture. The hope of the righteous brings joy. We have to look ahead to work back to achieve a joy now. Right? I guess here's a good way of maybe, well, maybe it's not a good way, but it came to my mind. And some of you may not even remember this, and so you'd be like, maybe Google it, put it on YouTube. But there was a thing called the Super Bowl Shuffle that the 85 Chicago Bears did. Yeah, I know, a football illustration, right? But the Chicago Bears were so confident of their coming victory in the Super Bowl that before the Super Bowl even happened, they put out this little music video called the Super Bowl Shuffle. And I got to tell you, I can remember watching it, and obviously, who did the Bears play in the Super Bowl that year? The Patriots, right? And as a New Englander, or just in general, I didn't care for the Super Bowl Shuffle. I thought it was arrogant, right? But one thing you have to admit, right, when you saw Jim McMahon with the sunglasses on and everybody doing their thing, it was like they'd already won. They were so confident that nobody could take that victory from them. So they were rejoicing already. They were dancing. They were doing the Super Bowl Shuffle, right? Remember the lyrics, if you know it, right? We're not here looking for trouble. We're just here to do the Super Bowl Shuffle. Arrogant, maybe, yes, but confident that what they were going to achieve was not going to be taken from them. And I got to tell you, I remember when I worked on boats, I was in the Caribbean. And I was in the Caribbean originally, but we came back. And we landed our boat on the set of ESPN in Tampa when the Super Bowl was there that year. And this was not the Bears Super Bowl. This is years later, right? And so we're on the backdrop of ESPN, and a lot of really famous people came by. And I got to meet Marcus Allen, and Franco Harris, and I grew up in Pittsburgh, so that was like a huge thrill for me. And I remember Mike Ditka, the coach of the Bears in that 85 Super Bowl, he came by, and he looked like he had been having some fun, and he came by, and he stopped by our boat in this, you know, big private yacht that I'm working on, and I'm outside, the, you know, right in the front, and he starts talking to me about the boat, and he's just, you know, carrying on a conversation. He's like, wow, that boat's really something. And I said, yeah. I said, and I started talking about football, right? And I said, you know, what a dominant team they had in the Super Bowl that year, and yada, yada, yada. And he starts going on about it. Yeah, you know. And all of a sudden, I told him, well, you know, I'm from New England. And he looked at me, and he goes, you guys stunk, right? And I remember thinking, yeah, if you look at the score, it was probably the most dominant Super Bowl by a team ever, right? And so they had this vision where nobody was going to take it from them. They knew the outcome ahead of time. At least they appeared to, right? How much more should we feel that type of confidence? I'm not saying be arrogant. Please understand. That type of confidence when our vision of glory lies in the hands of a sovereign God who holds it all together. Nothing can take it from us. How much more confident should we be than even these otherworldly examples? How much more joy, shuffling joy, should we have? Like nobody's going to take it from us. When you look at that manger, do you see that victory? Do you see that reality? And does it produce a joy within you, right? And so the whole point of this series is this paradox of the Christian faith that exists between two Advents. The first Advent that we celebrate here in December, and the next Advent when Jesus Christ returns. And this in-between of these two Advents produces this paradox of faith, this desperation for Christ, and this joy that we already know him, this joy that we already experience him, this joy that we encounter him and he lives in here and we can feel him. We see the things he does in our life. As the body of Christ, we become his hands and his feet. And so there's this inexpressible joy that Christmas so represents. And yet, every time I look at the manger, I'm desperate for him to come again. I encounter him. I experience him. He works through me and through you. And yet I'm desperate like Paul was, or John was, to see face to face. Not a quiet desperation. Not one that's afraid. Not one that finds itself in a hopeless situation. But a joyful, exuberant desperation. Because we long to see him. That's what this series is about. A desperation that sings, shouts, rejoices because it's so alive in hope, peace, and the love of God. And living in this mystery of joyful desperation, that's the Christian paradox. That's the Christian challenge, right? Desperate because we long for more of him. Joyful because we're alive in him. And to understand this mystery, we have to look not only to now, but what is coming and work our way back. All right? So let's start with what's coming, the object of our faith and hope, and let's work it back to the manger. Because I'm going to submit to you today that the future reality, the coming reality, defines both our desperation, but also defines the joy we have now. Yes, what I'm saying is the coming reality of Christ and his kingdom defines the joy we experience now, even in waiting. Look again at the passage from Habakkuk that I used. I used it when I talked about hope in this series. And I've used this passage, this particular group of verses, quite a few times. All right? I've preached on this from the idea of taking joy and not letting circumstances define it. But I haven't fleshed out one particular thing, one particular piece of this that I feel is relevant for today. But let's start in verse 17, okay? Though the fig tree should not blossom, nor fruit be on the vines, the produce of the olive fail, and the fields yield no food, right? The flock be cut off from the fold, and there be no herd in the stalls. He has a vision, right, that he gets from the Lord, the prophet does, that trouble is coming to Israel, right? And he sees this, and he says, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will take joy in the God of my salvation. Now, I've preached on those verses, you know, and that idea of taking joy in no matter what the world throws at you. I've preached on that before. But what I want to highlight today that I think is particularly relevant for today actually happens in verse 16. Because not only did Habakkuk get a vision of being invaded, of Israel being invaded, okay, but he got another vision from the Lord. And it's here in verse 16. I hear and my body trembles. My lips quiver at the sound. Rottenness enters into my bones. My legs tremble beneath me. Yet, this is an important yet I will quietly wait for the day of trouble to come upon those who invade us. His joy and his hope come from a vision of redemption. Now, here's the point I want to make that I think is really relevant to us. If what he fears that's coming, the invasion, can produce fear in him, then doesn't the ultimate chapter of the book, the redemption of Israel, can't that also produce joy now? If you can have fear now for what is coming, then certainly you can take joy now for what is finally and ultimately coming. If you can do one, you can do the other, and how much more so the other, knowing that's the final chapter, that's the final log. Why should our fear of the future chapter of life be more defining in our lives than the joy of the final chapter? Let me say that one more time in case you missed it. Why should our fear of a future chapter in life, which is really relevant today, be more defining in our lives than the joy of the final chapter? When God seals up the hand of time and it's life ever after. That's the vision we have to have in Christ and in the manger. To have joy on Christmas now, we have to start with the resurrection. We have to start with the empty tomb. We have to start with the victory and work our way back to land on the manger. And that's the only way you'll experience joy now. The empty tomb, right, is the hope of our future advent. Let me give you an example about something you're looking forward to, right, that produces joy now. My parents, it was their 50th anniversary. Now, this is going to sound funny, but my mother has always wanted to go to a dude ranch. She wanted our whole family, all the grandkids, all the children, to all go and have a vacation on a dude ranch. Why she has this idea, I don't know. Right, but that was her desire. So we were planning, thinking, well, what can we do for their 50th? We want to do something special, and obviously with the COVID restrictions, we couldn't, you know, have fanfare, and they didn't want it. But we wanted to do something special, and so we thought, you know, let's give them that dude ranch experience, right? So we booked this dude ranch, and when my parents opened up their gift, which we just put like exactly what we were going to do, you know, print it off on the internet and gave him a copy of it. You know, my mother's face lit up, right? And my father looked at her and he was smiling. And there was this, from that point on, the rest of the night, there was this incredible joy at the dinner table. We were laughing, thinking about what was to come, right? I was picturing my father in a 10-gallon hat, just hysterical. I was picturing him climbing on a horse and I was hysterical. We were all having a laugh. We were joyful for something that hadn't happened yet because of the hope of it coming. How much more so, I'll say again, should the assurance of hope that we have through faith that comes from the love of God not produce not only peace in our life, but joy in our life? We should have laughter. We should have this sense of triumphant, you know, joy that just rejoicing in our life. If I can laugh off my chair about my father getting on a horse with a 10-gallon hat, which isn't happening till June, I can certainly celebrate and rejoice that someday I'll see my Savior face to face, not just in a manger, but face to face. And so again, the empty tomb is the hope of our future advent. Listen to John 16:22. Jesus says, you have sorrow now, right? You're going to have sorrow. He even says you're going to have troubles. There's going to be great sorrows. But I will see you again. There's the coming reality. And your hearts will rejoice and no one will take your joy from you. There was Christmas joy on the first advent. Right? When the day Jesus was born, there was joy, but sorrow still came. But one day, a greater joy than Christmas is going. And yes, what I'm submitting to you today is, if you want your joy to be Christ-like joy, if you want your joy to be unchangeable and unaffected by the sands of time, your joy has to come from the resurrection, even on Christmas morning. Because the resurrection is the greater joy. The greatest joy, our manger joy, has to be defined by the resurrection joy. And the cross, right? We think about this symbol of suffering, the reality of Christ dying, right? It was the means that sealed this final chapter, that sealed this future advent. Look at Hebrews 12:2. Looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. Jesus had a vision of where he belonged, but notice, he endured so much for the joy that was set before him, and that joy is the kingdom. Think about it this way. Jesus' joy included you and me with him. He's willing to endure all that. All that. Because his joy was having all God's children, all the sons and daughters in the kingdom with him. God found it great joy to have us in the kingdom. Can we have joy now from that reality? Because if you understand that, you understand the king is in that manger. And that's going to lead us to Palm Sunday. Because like the tomb, like the cross, even the palms and the waving and the yelling of Hosanna is for today. It wasn't just for Palm Sunday back 2,000 plus years ago. The palms are for today. The palms are for one day in the kingdom. We read in Revelation, like palm branches will be. Why? Shouting Hosanna in kingship. Even what we celebrate on Palm Sunday, right? As Jesus rode into Jerusalem, was pointing to a greater reality from which we get our joy. And what does it say about that time that the people who would eventually even turn on him, but were still so excited and joyful about the prospect of the kingdom? Matter of fact, that's what let them down. That's why they turned on him. They didn't expect there to be a little delay. They didn't expect the cross. But listen to the way they reacted. Matthew 21:9, and the crowds that went before him and that followed him were shouting, right? A joyful desperation for the kingdom. Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Verse 15 says that they were indignant when they were told to be quiet because of the great joy that they had for the coming kingdom of God. If they can have that, not knowing that the cross was coming next, how much more should we have that and not be fazed and not be moved and not be turned because we know about the empty tomb? How much more so us, who know not only the manger, not only the ride to Jerusalem, not only Calvary, but know that he sits at the right hand of God and he lives and even breathes in us through the Spirit. How much more so should we have the palms? Palm Sunday is for today. Easter is for today. The cross is for today. Merry Christmas. Our experiences with him and his love is our assurance. That assurance is our joy. See, when you finally work back from the manger, from the tomb, from the cross to the palms, from the palms to the manger, you have to find the manger as empty as the tomb. I know, it's Christmas. Can't we just see little baby Jesus? What was that saying from the movie? Oh, I can't think of it now. I like the baby Jesus. Sweet baby Jesus, that's it. But still omnipotent. Right? You have to find the manger empty. Because that child grew up. That child had a destiny that was far beyond Bethlehem. That child's destiny was Jerusalem, not Bethlehem. You don't believe me? Listen to Zechariah, John the Baptist's father, who realizes what his son is going to do to pave the way for Christ. And he speaks about this coming salvation that Jesus is going to bring. He says, "Blessed be the Lord God of Israel." This is from Luke 1, 68. "For he has visited and redeemed his people, and he's raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David." In verse 77, he says, "To give knowledge of salvation to his people and the forgiveness of their sins." He tied the Christmas event to the salvation event, to the cross, to the tomb. What about Simeon, the saint who waited in the temple and was told he wouldn't die until he had seen the Lord's salvation, the birth of the Christ? What does he say? Luke 2, 29, "Lord, now you are letting your servant depart in peace according to your word, for my eyes have seen your salvation that you've prepared in the presence of all peoples, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people Israel." The joy of Christmas has always been tied to the salvation of the cross and the empty tomb. It's always been, even at the first Christmas, they tied it to that. The rejoicing of Christmas is the rejoicing of Easter. Because if not, if there was no Easter, if there was no rejoicing at the resurrection and Easter never happened, then all the manger is the birth of another carpenter. That's all it is. If the resurrection isn't true, if the tomb wasn't empty, then we're celebrating the birth of a carpenter. No, we got to look, we got to start at the tomb, at the resurrection, and work our way back to the manger. Before I close, I want to go back to that Thoreau quote I mentioned in the beginning, and I want to work it back again, but this time from a faith perspective, right? Desperation. "We are desperate for you, but not hopeless, God. Our hope is assured." Our desperation only comes from that thing in us that says, "Maranatha, Lord, come again," but definitely not hopeless. Quiet desperation, afraid to admit or feel, not us, not us. Our desperation is joyful, joyful and triumphant. "Oh, come, all ye faithful," to a joyful desperation, indignant to chant Hosanna, like nobody can quiet us down. Lead lives, right? Lead lives of quiet desperation. It defines them, it runs them, it directs them. Well, the life in Christ, the kingdom now and the kingdom that is coming, our assured hope, defines our life now. It's what leads our life. It's the way the master takes us and leads us like sheep. To where the well is never dry. To motivate and inspire us. But let's not forget the opening of that verse. Most men lead lives of quiet desperation. Most men, see in this one, we're told that the path in Christ is narrow and few find it. So we can only ask, have you found it? Have I found it? And if so, we are men and women who lead lives of joyful desperation. In spite of all the pressures and uncertainties, we have a super redemption shuffle of confidence because we know no one can take it from us. I mean, dance a little, sing a little, right? We're not here to be bound by trouble. We're just here to sing, to shout, to rejoice in the redemption shuffle. Why can't we do that dance? Because on Christmas morning, we should be singing from the end back to the manger. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know Christmas happened. He lives within my heart. Join with me in prayer. Father, thank you for Christmas, but it wouldn't mean anything if it wasn't for the tomb and the cross. I thank you for Jesus. I thank you for his birth. I thank you for his death. I thank you for his life forevermore. I thank you that he's our teacher, that he's our Savior, and that he's our Lord. Teach us to work it back from the resurrection to Bethlehem, from Calvary in Jerusalem to Bethlehem, so that we can find the joy that can't be taken away. A joyful desperation. Amen. Thank you, everybody. We're going to go to a worship that will be a little different. You'll see. Welcome back, everyone. We're going to do something very different with this worship set, even though it's the Sunday before Christmas. So as you heard in the sermon, I think it's really important that the rejoicing that we have on Christmas, we tie to the rejoicing that we have on the Resurrection Sunday. And kind of looking, as we did today, through the eyes of the empty tomb, back through the cross and finding the manger there, how appropriate it might be to sing He Lives on Christmas, right? Our Savior is born and He lives, and we're tying it all the way to the Easter song, He Lives. So we're going to do a couple fun things that kind of match what we did in the sermon. There's going to be something about Easter. There's going to be something about Palm Sunday, because we're celebrating His kingship, right? And we talked about looking at the kingship of the Christ child through the eyes of Palm Sunday. And so to tie it all in, we've got kind of a fun little medley that you've probably never heard on Christmas before. So here we go. I serve a risen Savior, He's in the world today. I know that He is living, whatever men may say. I see His hands of mercy, I hear His voice of cheer. And just the time I need Him, He's always there. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives within my heart. Rejoice, rejoice, O Christian, lift up your voice and sing. Eternal hallelujahs to Jesus Christ the King, the hope of all who seek Him, the help of all who find. None other is so loving, so good and kind. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives within my heart.
The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice.
name above all names. God, we're going to use this whole medley today to think about not only Christmas, but the reason for Christmas, and that means the cross. It means your kingship. It means the empty tomb. It means that your birth has provided a way for us to be renewed and reborn. And so we sing, Lord God, with a sense of rejoicing, that same rejoicing, Lord, that cried Hosanna, the same rejoicing that people had when they realized you're alive. I see the King of Glory coming on clouds with fire. Lord, take us from the manger to the clouds. faithful,
joyful and triumphant.
Oh, come ye, oh, come ye to Bethlehem.
Come and behold him, born the King of angels.
Oh, come, let us adore him.
Oh, come, let us adore him.
Oh, come, let us adore
him, Christ the Lord.
What time to see? Adore him, Christ the Lord.
Lord, we end right where we began on Christmas morning. Today, Lord, I thank you not only for your birth, but for your life and for your death and for your life forevermore. Oh, come, all ye faithful. Come to Bethlehem. Come to Jerusalem. Come to Calvary. And Lord, we look forward to the day that you call us right up alongside of you in the home that has been created for us even before the foundations of the world, paradise. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, everyone. Merry Christmas to you. We'll see you next week. God bless.
Welcome back, everyone. Devotion time. I want to do something different than I've done in the past with these devotions. I want you to journal. Okay, make it just a journal. Or you can even take a piece of paper and a pen and just write what I'm about to say down. If you're absolutely defiant against journaling, you can make a mental journal in your head. But I actually think it would be helpful to write it down. So, point in the sermon that I think we can flush out a little bit more is Habakkuk, if you remember, he gets a vision of trouble coming to Israel, and then he gets a vision of redemption for his people, and he knows the redemption piece wins out. So because of that, and in light of that, if we were to summarize that book in its conclusion, is Habakkuk chooses to take the joy of redemption, of the coming redemption, and have that triumph over the fear of the coming trouble, because he knows one will outweigh and outlast the other. And so for him, that means I'm going to take joy rather than fear, because I know the final chapter, and that is more dominant in defining me and defining my state than the next chapter that I may not like, because that one's going to close the book. That's going to be the Alpha and the Omega, is redemption. And so we looked at Christmas and said, you got to look at it through the eyes of Easter. You got to look at it through the eyes of the resurrection if you really want a reason to rejoice, right? Otherwise, we're just celebrating the birth of a carpenter. But if we're celebrating the birth of the one who's crucified and resurrected, then we're celebrating the birth of the Savior, the Messiah, the King. And so that joy has to be what defines Christmas joy. And so here's what I want us to do. I want you to write down if you can, or take a mental note if you don't want to. And I want you to list the things that are the most troubling in your life. Make a list of the things you worry about the most. Because what's interesting and what's even different than Habakkuk is most of what we worry about, you know, what do they say, 90%, never even occurs, doesn't even come true. Whereas the resurrection and the sure and certain hope that is in Christ, that we have confidence in, right? Like we read about in our scriptures, Peter talking about the confidence that we have in that, you know, from Hebrews, right? That faith is the assurance of things hoped for. And so how much more should the joy that comes from that dominate who we are? And so I want you to make a list of the things that are the most troubling in your life that bring you anxiety, sadness, fear, whatever it might be. And then I want you to really take a few minutes, however long you want to, close your eyes if you have to, and I want you just to jot down any joy that you might find about heaven, about seeing Jesus face to face. Is it loved ones you'll see? Is it the removal of pain and suffering? Is it the removal of fear itself? What it might be like, what you're hoping for in that eternal state. And I want you just to keep writing it down. And I want you to look at the end and then ask yourself, am I more joyful or more fearful? Do I take joy or do I wallow in the trouble? And then I want you to think about the manger, but not until then. Then I want you to think about what Christmas means. And so that's my devotional thought for today. Again, if you can get the paper and the pen out, do so. We'll see you next week, everybody. God bless you.